Huzzah, Rangers. This is Phil Harris again here at the Jack's Ranger Show. I am joined, as always, with Dave McVeigh. We've got a very special guest this time around, a youth rugby coach in the form of Daniel Mejia. How are you, sir?
Doing great, guys. I watch you guys. I've been watching you guys for a long time, so I'm really excited to be here.
We appreciate it, man. We're happy that you're here for sure. Let's talk about where you're from, first and foremost.
Oh, okay. So that's a long story. So I'm from Mexico. I'm a true immigrant. I came here when I was 9. It's just the right time to be able to lose the accent. But when I start hanging out with my friends, my Latino friends, the accent sometimes comes out really heavy. Mm-hmm. But the accent left, and I went from Mexico, Guadalajara, which is kind of like a lots of universities over there, lots of museums. Mm-hmm. It's close to the Pacific Ocean. It's up in a valley, so it's in the 70s year round. We have two seasons. There's the raining season and the dry season. Mm-hmm. And then from there, we decided to come to Boston, Massachusetts, because, you know, why not, right? That's exactly right. What you want to do.
Yes. Pretty much the same weather-wise, yeah. You know.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And actually, I came in December 1980, so we had I missed the blizzard of 79, okay. But there was a bunch of blizzards that followed that one, and everybody was all like ginger about blizzards because of the fact that was it 79 or 76, whatever it was, the big one.
Before my time.
Everybody was all ginger about it. And like people right now make fun of the fact that like eggs and bread and butter and milk, you know, everything, you know, everybody gets really hungry for like French toast after a snowstorm or yeah. When a snowstorm is coming. Like it was like people were panicking because people had been stuck in their cars for a week.
Right.
Yeah. So I came from Mexico. We had the tiki-tac type of soccer over there, street soccer. You know, everybody mm-hmm. in Mexico is born with a soccer ball. And that was my experience. That's what I came from. And I came to the United States and Boston, Massachusetts when I was 9 years old and Go Heat School. It was a lot of fun. I came at the exact right time. Like a big snowstorm had just come. They had just cleared everything away. So people were actually able to get me out of the airport. And then 2 days later, there was a huge snowstorm. And then 2 weeks later, there was another huge snowstorm. So I went from tiki-tac soccer in the sun, 70 degrees year round. Well, 70s, 80s year round. It was one train ride away from the coast. So everybody just got on the train and mm-hmm. went to the coast. They went to Puerto Vallarta and Manzanillo and had a fantastic time. Came to the United States and it was just, I was snowed in. I was cold. I'd never seen snow before. And it was awesome. Oh my God. It was a sled. I was, you know, there was so much snow. I was tunneling through the snow. There was kids everywhere, you know, because there was, you know, back in the day before like fun got sucked out, mm-hmm. there was snow days. So yeah. Like kids just rioted into the streets, right? Like really slow ride because it's like, oh, snow, snow. But we'd all just ride into the snow and it was awesome. I absolutely loved it. I had a charmed youth, both in Mexico and in the United States. You know, then, you know, so moving on, you know, where did you come from? What was your rugby journey? I think you're about to ask me.
Yeah.
So I got through fourth grade, fifth grade, all that fun stuff of learning what it is to be like an American, right? So I tried soccer over here because I love soccer. For some reason, I hated the way it was being done. I can't explain it.
Totally different in terms of like the gameplay and what it felt like to play. Yeah,
exactly. It was just I can't analyze it. I don't know because it was so long ago, but I was just so turned off by it. And I remember thinking like people are just not having fun. Huh. This is just not fun. Nobody's having fun. People are miserable. They're just not having fun. Now, again, this would have been like in the 80s, right? So like the World Soccer Cup hadn't even arrived in the United States. The World Soccer Cup was 95, 96, 98, 96, 99, I think. Late 96. Okay. So like soccer was a thing, but it wasn't a big thing yet. So I did, you know, grade school and middle school. And it was also around the time that the Celtics were just like exploding, right? So for some reason, I gave up soccer. I hated soccer. I started trying to watch American football. I just didn't understand it. It was just really boring. But I loved basketball because like it was it you turn over the ball, now you're in offense, now you're in defense, right. Now you're in offense, you know, oh it's so fast and all this and all that. I tried it at school, I was miserable at it, but I was having fun. I think it was at that time people were you know, there was, you know, the whole Larry Bird, you know, yeah. era versus Magic Johnson and everything, like, you know, the 76ers and Irwin, like everything. It was just basketball was just fun. So yeah. I was having a lot of fun playing with my friends. I was just awful at it. I was god awful. I'm 5'6" at best when I'm wearing heels, you know. I'm in like Prince, I like to wear really tall heels so I can make myself look taller. And it was just it's just so basketball hit like all like the all the fun in me. So I enjoyed that for a while. And went to high school. By then, I knew that basketball was. I knew that. You know, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, right? I was. Mm-hmm. I was not going to be Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. I was not going to make it, or Chief, you know, or Robert Parrish. I was not going to hit any of those. So I'll do what, you know, American, I was trying to be, you know, American, let's do what American kids, I'll try to do football. I had fun with football and I think I started growing into it. My shoulders started coming out. The beer gut wasn't there yet. So I could actually move around quite a bit. Right.
Right.
So I was having fun with football and then one day, you know, walking back from football practice, I saw these kids playing this other thing. Never seen it before, had no idea what it was. All I know is that half the team said, no, dude, you don't want to go over there. That's just crazy. So, of course, you know, I dropped off my equipment. Then I went back to see what that was. And I had a blast because I couldn't do basketball anymore. And basketball was just fun, you know. Yeah. I was probably the worst basketball player to be on your team because I sucked. And all I did was just laugh and just do weird stuff, right? You know?
Nice.
So
basketball's then, fun that way. It's probably the most, there's something about it. You really don't have to be very good at basketball. As long as somebody's not, you know, just slapping the ball in your face.
You don't have
to be very good at basketball to have fun playing basketball. It's a very easy sport to just kind of goof around.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, you can always pass the ball to somebody else, mm-hmm. set somebody else up to take a shot.
Oh yeah,
exactly. And I think, you know, the it's funny now that we're talking about this, it's getting me thinking, you know, back in the day in Mexico when you played soccer, a lot of times you pass the ball up to the guy further up, and then, you know, because you were a little bit back, you'd make fun of the defense and like dance around and just do like whatever, just to like, because you could goof around. And in basketball there's also like a lot of switching, you know, like you pass the ball to you could circle around the back, and while you're doing that you can, you know, goof on everybody else, or at least that's how I played basketball. So I like playing it that way. Nobody knew what, you know, nobody knew what I was doing, but I didn't care because I was having a lot of fun. So then I drop off my equipment and start walking back. I start looking at this thing, and they just grabbed me and pulled me in, you know. And I figured out that that's a huge part of everybody's rugby experience in as far as like the your genesis, like what, mm-hmm. what is your origin story to rugby? And half the time is, well, I was, you know, I was this brooding child, or maybe I wasn't, but somebody grabbed me and they're like, you're coming with me. And it's like, and you experience rugby that way. And it's so much fun. I tell you, it's like 90% of all stories I ever heard of rugby and people enjoying rugby getting pulled into rugby is because somebody was already in there, reached out, and in many cases physically grabbed them and pulled them in there, or made it so that you were going to be there. So they threw me in there. I was having I was scissoring back and forth. I was doing all these weird things, and it was okay because the game kind of expected it. Yep. It was just awesome. I right there started this very long love affair, you know, that many times, you know, it hasn't been a two-way street, you know. Times it's been kind of a bad codependent relationship. Other times it's been this beautiful thing that just enriches my life and brings me life and everything, and other times it's been a destructive, you know. And but if it's I guess it as you go through the different stages in life and as you go through the different stages in rugby. I mean, you know, I think everybody's tried to quit rugby 5 or 6 or 20 times. I've tried to quit a bunch of times. It's such a deep, rich sport. You know, the rabbit hole is so deep that if you're not having fun, you're not doing it right. You're stuck in whatever rut you're in. You're not looking at it from another aspect. And that's just the playing part of it. Like, never mind the refereeing of it, the coaching of it. There's just so many layers to it. That it's astounding. It's been a wonderful, wonderful trip.
Daniel, that was awesome. Thank you for that. You definitely answered the question.
That's
how I started. Sorry, yeah,
where did you play after that? Like, what club? Right. Is that in the Boston club scene school scene or what?
Yeah. So I was very lucky. So I Brookline High School. I started at Brookline High School. So I'll give my lineage. You know, this is the song of my people. I'll give you my lineage, and then I'll drill into any one of those that you want to hear about. So the first time that I was exposed to rugby was at Brookline High School. Played there, and there was this, I didn't understand until later, but there's this not so hidden secret that if you play for Brookline High School, your older brother team is the Boston Men. So that's where you were gonna play afterwards. Mm-hmm. And there's a couple stages in between. During the summers, there was the Acton 10. I don't know if it's still going or not, but Brookline High School put a Brookline High School team there. And it was really, 99% Boston Men, plus maybe some other people that joined up that either wanted to, we let them in, or they were, I don't know, they were just weirdos, we let them in. Because rugby always has that remainder. There's always like that thing that hangs on, you know, that little vest or whatever it is, but you're like, yeah, that's okay, they're weird, but they're with us. Mm-hmm. So I did Brookline High School, then I did, there was Brandeis University in between. I forgot about that. So I did college for a while. And that was a huge disappointment, but it was actually a wonderful thing. It's one of those things where, like, when a door closes, a window is open type of situation.
Right.
So I did Brookline High School, Brandeis University, Boston Men. Then the company that I was working for, Fortune 500, top five Fidelity Investments. I was working for Fidelity for a long time.
Yep.
They moved down to Rhode Island. I did the reverse commute for three, four years. And then finally, what's that saying? I divorced the club and quit the girlfriend, and went to Rhode Island. Actually, I apologize. Divorcing the club was hard. And I apologize. I didn't quit the girlfriend. Things actually didn't work out. So I came down to Rhode Island, and it was at a time when I thought, okay, I'm not, now I'm going to be a pop practice only player, second half B side sunny day. But things the way they were, I just played for another 5 or 6 years with Providence Men, and then transitioned to coaching men and women here in Providence. I had actually coached already in college. That's where the whole Brandeis thing, saying it was awful, but it was wonderful. That's where I sort of started coaching over there. Went to Boston, went to Providence. Coached there coached for a while, and then took a sabbatical to start raising my own rugby club, two boys. And before I knew it, there was this thing called youth rugby, and I got swallowed up into it literally without expecting it. So there's a lot of stories there. There's a story about what was going on at college rugby. There's a lot about what was going on at Boston Men. There's a lot going on at Providence, and then at youth. Do you want to hear about any of those?
I want to hear about how you got into coaching youth rugby. That's what we're wanting to hear.
Okay. So yeah. So what I'm focusing right now is coaching youth, and everything that I've learned about coaching has been preparing me for this moment.
All right.
So my coaching journey was, I started at Brookline High School as a player. I played under Ian Ryrie. That was the longest running high school program in the Northeast. Him and Gary Smalls started programs one after another to be able to play one another. So it was Brookline Marshfield. And by the time I joined in 1990, around that time period, it had already been going for about like 20 years. Ian Ryrie was a giant of a man. He was like 5'4" or two, but his personality was just huge. And he'd had that program going for, he had that program going for about 20 years before I arrived. So it was really firing on all cylinders. He did stuff that I literally did not realize until like 20 years later. Like one of my biggest, most glorious moments in rugby life was at the Acton 10. Life circles around. We were playing together on the same team. I was playing with my coach.
Yeah.
We won the game. We won the tournament, and I got to drink Harpoon out of the cup, as being passed around, and Ian passed it to me. And it was just such an incredible moment to be like, I'm drinking Harpoon with like my high school coach. This is incredible. So I was playing it was a great program. It was an excellent program. And then I went to collegiate men's division III, which was awful. It really was. It was a lot of fun. Don't get me wrong. It's so much fun. So I showed up with my cleats. I showed up with my kit. I went to practice. I went right into the drills, and they're like, their jaw dropped. They're like, how do you know what's going on? And I was like, I played Brooklyn High School. I thought everybody played rugby. They're like, no, you're starting on Saturday. In 2 days. Right. So I played scrum half for a while. Now I went into my college career thinking high school rugby is like brought me up to a level. I can't wait to play at the next level.
Right.
And I went to high school, and then I went to college, and it was like, woo. So suddenly they're like, oh, well, you're going to have to be a starter. You're going to have to be the captain. You're going to have to be the coach. And I was like,
right. Right. You got to teach us how to play rugby.
You're good at this. Exactly. Yeah. And I was like, no, I don't know how to coach it. I only know how to play it.
Yeah.
USA Rugby was doing a lot to get the coaching, and, Jarge Hook and Eddie O'Sullivan were running their USA Rugby coaching programs at that point. And we all drove out to North Adams, Massachusetts. And got a coaching certificate. It was a lot of fun. That was awesome. I got to talk and chat and think rugby with a lot of people. And it was an incredible amount of fun. So I was disappointed in the rugby playing, which pushed me into coaching. And then I sort of followed up, kept coaching through that. Then I coached Brandeis men, Brandeis women, Division III. We tried to do this cool thing, which was like select side for Division III, to then go over to like, I think it was the Beast of the East and play, with a select side from D3, other teams. So I did all that. I coached Providence men, Providence women. When I was trying to figure out how to coach, especially women, because Brandeis started a women's club. And I thought, all those great motivational things that I've seen coaches, Ian never did this. So I'll give that let me walk that back. But especially other sports, and the type of vitriol that just spews out of people to try to motivate young men, I was ready to start using all those foul language words to motivate women. And I realized this is not going to work at all. Like, this is just not, this is not right.
Right.
So I thought like, do you coach men and women differently? Like, what do I do? Where do I go to find out these secrets? And Beantown women were like just down the street. In fact, they were practicing at the same field that Boston men were practicing at. And at that point, I basically stopped playing with Brandeis, and I just started going to Boston men as a college kid, and then just coaching Brandeis. So then after practices, or I'd show up early. I can't remember if it was late or early. I don't remember. It was late. I would stay late. and watch the women practice. And they had just some incredible coaches. Joni was there at that time and Walter was there. I got to chatting with Walter. He's just a fantastic human being. He just is. So I just understudied with them. And at one point I set it up so winter practices, they could come to Brandeis and we practiced together in the same gym. So I got to like watch them for a while, learn from them. I started going over there to like really figure out what they were doing. Then I brought them over to Brandeis University. And so I started getting more of those little tools in my tool belt, you know, for coaching. Mm-hmm. And then fast forward, because we're supposed to talk about, you know, youth. Fast forward, I find out that there's a youth program in Rentham, Massachusetts. And I live in Providence. So, whoa, that's weird. Well, I'm super excited. I've got to go see this. I tell my wife, you know, I'm going to go see this rugby thing in Rentham. She's like, yes, you should go do that. Okay, fine. So I'm getting ready. You know, I wait till Sunday morning because youth rugby, for the most part, practices Sunday mornings, which is just a terrible joke for anybody that's still playing and trying to coach. So Sunday morning, I get myself ready. I'm about to go. And she goes, I'm about to leave. I'm leaving out the door. And she opens the door and she goes, what are you doing? And I was like, wife, we spoke about this. You know, I could do what I can, what I, you know, what I want, as long as I clear it with you. I told you I was going to do this youth rugby thing. And she goes, yes, why aren't you bringing the kids? And I was like, yes, that's really stupid. Why am I not bringing the kids? Yeah, I was thinking it for me. I wanted to see, because I heard that some of the guys that I played with were coaching at that point. So I took the kids. We went over there and had an awesome time. It was like, it was like a high school reunion or something. Half the guys I played with were there. We're having a great time. The kids are having a great time. I'm sitting in the sidelines, trying not to be that Pop Warner, you know, dad, like, you know, running out there, always telling my kid what to do. But they threw me a bone. They're like, hey, wait a second. You know, rugby and coaching, would you like to come out and join? I was like, no, I don't. Okay, fine. Yeah, I'll do it. So I ran out there and it just very, very, very quickly became clear. Kind of like that moment where I realized that I can't use that vitriol to motivate women, right? All those skills that you have as an elite coach to motivate and shape and build up elite players. No, throw that out the window. If you start doing 2v1s, if you start doing drills, even if they're not very complicated, you have lost them. And, you know, rule number one in coaching is, which I'm violating right now completely. And you see my personality. Talk less. Just talk less. You know, there's no way you're going to be able to impart on anybody the entire vast. And I tell you, my rugby knowledge is encyclopedic.
Absolutely.
I think of myself as a forward, but I'm also a student of backs. Mm-hmm. So my knowledge, my encyclopedic knowledge of rugby is, and I want to convey all of that in one conversation. Everything I know from A to C, that's about as far as I know. You know, other people I know D, E, F all the way to Z, but you know, everything I know, I want to be able to just impart, as long as they just sit there and stare at me and watch me as I speak nonstop for 20 minutes. That doesn't work for anybody.
Right.
Even less for kids. You talk to them for more than like 15 seconds, you've already lost half of them. You gotta get them going. You gotta break break rugby down into its absolute core. And then take that and break it down into what its constituent like pieces. And then every single one of those, break it down like, oh, I've got the perfect drill. Great. Break that down 10 times so that like the first part of the drill you run is literally them not knowing that they're starting this. And I don't think of them as drills or activities. I think of them as progressions. Here's the start of progression and it's got 10 steps. And if you can build it into a good game of sharks and minnows, if you can do sharks and minnows, then you start at, oh, you guys are doing great. Let me challenge you. Let me go throw this other challenge because you guys are doing great. Oh, you guys are doing great with that. Let me throw this other challenge. Don't explain it. Just throw the challenge out. And then when like some of them pick it up, say, hey, watch these kids. They're doing great. Then you're probably doing okay-ish. Okay-ish with kids. But that's been a lot of fun. I found Rentham. They were amazing. I mean, they were just, they've been working. They, you know, shout out Barbarians. If I had the background, see if I could put it on. Barbarians were just amazing. They were great. They'd already been there for a while. They were evolving. I showed up. I had a lot of coaching experience. They did not. So we sat down and we did a lot of great thinking at the bar and figured out, like, where do we need to get to? I was able to show them a lot of, like, you know, coaching fundamentals that I knew of. We grew as friends and as a coaching staff. Every single one of those coaches in that program is just fantastic. If anybody's thinking of getting into coaching youth, or if you coach youth, just go watch them for just one practice. I think there should be a lot more cross-pollinating of different coaches going to different practices, even at the highest level. In fact, the best coaches, even at the highest level, they do that, you know. Players, you know how, like, when you're a single player and you don't have a team and you lend yourself out to another team? Mm-hmm. I think coaches should be doing that. And the most successful coaches seem to do that. They lend themselves. They just show up somewhere and they start, you know, they start learning from, and there's no secrets. Nobody's going to, maybe, okay, at the highest levels, yes, maybe they want to keep the game plan, you know, folder, or, you know, the calls and all that kind of hidden. But for the most part, most coaches are pretty happy with, like, you know, you're a developing coach, you're a developing team. Just come out. I'll show you what we do. Don't come too often so you don't get all our secrets. But,
right.
But I that's really, that's admirable. I love that. I've never had, I think some of my best memories are just picking up. Like, I went to selections camp a bunch in college, not as a player. I went over there and be like, hey, can I help out? I just want to see how you run a selections camp. And they're like, they didn't know what to do. Well, who do you coach? I coach a nobody team, but I want to learn from you guys. What was his name? He's got a podcast right now. It'll come to me later. Peter Steinberg. He was doing select side at that point. And it was in New England. It was in the area. So I just went to help. It's like, I'll be a semi-autonomous cone. You tell me to stand here and do a couple things. I'll just stand here and I'll just learn. And that was a lot of fun. So coaching youth has been, it's been so fulfilling. It's been a lot of fun. And it's frustrating as it is at times. I tell you, everybody's coach, that player that just is uncoachable. And at least here they have an excuse.
Very good.
They're just not old enough to get it yet, you know, right. As opposed to the other side. They're just like, I was a big fish in a small pond and I will not change what I do. It's like, great. Right. Thank you. I can't implement this new defense, which is now like super old and everybody's doing it because you won't do it. Right. What's that joke? How many vets does it take to change a light bulb? Change. I'm not dissing on them. I really am not. When things start going wrong in a game or in a season or something, your vets have seen it all. They've been there from, you know, they're like the bassist, or they're like the drummer to a great rock and roll band. Any, you know, your fly half, your younger players start freaking out. You just tell them, just watch the vets. The right. Vets will settle everything down. They'll fix it. You know, no matter how wrong this seems right now, just hang with the vets. Sometimes they're the ones that are a little bit hardest to be able to finagle into a new, you know, system of any sort, but they're the ones that are going to save you every single time. So I joked a little bit, love the vets. But yeah, these youths, the ones that are uncoachable, at least they have an excuse, you know. They're little, they will, you know, they'll get older and their nervous systems will develop and allow you to actually get more coaching into them. But yeah, it's really exciting. And the Free Jacks right now, whoa, you know, they've been absolutely phenomenal. I cannot thank youth in Massachusetts and Rhode Island. Like, we cannot thank the Free Jacks enough. They've just been phenomenal in being able to everything, you know, top to bottom. They're doing the regional camp stuff, which is amazing. And then also they're going out and doing these outreach events, which is just amazing. You know, it's one thing me trying to recruit a couple of players. It's me trying to just show a few, you know, and it's hard. It's really hard to be able to find new players and bring them to you. But what we've been able to do is just schedule them at high schools and middle schools, at rec centers, and they show up with a bag of balls. They show up with a bunch of starters. Mm-hmm. We had this summer, they've come to Rhode Island three times. I've been very lucky. We've developed this relationship. We had a camp. It was a 3-week camp during vacation. It was 8:30 or 9 to 3, I think, or 5. I don't know. My brain was fried. I was 9 to 3, I think. It was basically like the full school day. Mm-hmm. So Dave LaFlemme, amazing Brown coach, a coach for Brown University men. He was running the high school kids. Me and Chris Gray were running the youth kids, elementary through middle school. I was lucky. I took time vacation. I was able to be there the entire time. Not everybody can do that. And I can only do that once. That's it. I'm not going to be able to do it ever again this year. At one point we reached out, you know, Jeff Karras, he's the president for Rhode Island Rugby. So the governing body for youth in Rhode Island, he reached out to the Free Jacks and, hey, you know, we're doing this. Would you guys be able to come out? I hear you're doing these outreach events. And they sent 5 Free Jacks and 3 nice. were starting later that week. So we had it a Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. They came on a Wednesday. I'm gonna get this wrong, but I'm gonna try anyway. Slade came, Peter came, and the mechanic Jackson Johnston. He came. Blew my mind. I thought it was gonna be like, I don't know who was gonna show up. I literally had no idea who was gonna show up. 3 came, right? Wheels came, who like coordinates all these things, right? Yeah. And is like, my jaw dropped that 3 starters and Wheels was coming over. Jenny showed up, and she literally later that week was not starting for the Free Jacks. He was an airplane flying overseas to go play with the Harlequins overseas. You know, England is doing that their premier Allianz Premier League.
Yes.
Yep.
Oh my God, that's amazing. And as much fun as I've had watching the men's 5 Nations, dude, wait 2 weeks later and the women's 5 Nation goes on. Oh, it is amazing. It's just absolutely phenomenal. So I was shocked that I was getting 3, that we were getting 3, you know, 3 starters. Wheels was coming over. And then Jenny, you know, who was later, she's in the Eagle Pool. So she's in the Eagle Pool and playing Harlequin. So it just blew my mind.
Daniel, I hate to interrupt, but we're about a minute and 50 seconds away from having to exit the video here. So I want to do something real quick. Just a quick question for you. How can people help youth rugby in New England? Just real quick.
Yeah, I think right now exposure is really what's important. The hardest thing is being able to be effective as a club. So don't be shy about asking your friends, your cousins, your whatever, to see if you can get kids out to teams that are already out there. Okay. Mm-hmm. So it's easy to say, well, yeah, just donate. Yeah, absolutely. Donate money is gonna help immensely, because there's not a lot of money right now in youth rugby. But the other thing is an existing club or a new club that's starting. Brooklyn, Massachusetts, I think, has a new club that's just starting. I think they have like 6, 7, 8 kids. I don't know. I've seen pictures on Facebook. You can't get a lot done with 5 or 6 kids, right? If they had 17, 18, 12, 14 kids, that makes a huge difference. And so now you're getting, you know, critical mass to be able to have really meaningful practices. So you know, different coaches might tell you otherwise, but I think right now the most important thing is grab your nephew, grab the kid down the down the street, you know, go make sure it's okay with their parents before you grab them and take them, right?
Right.
But because we were saying early, you know, the origin story to most people is you grab them and you physically bring them. Mm-hmm. Do that, but first make sure it's okay with the parents, because you're going to be in all kinds of legal complications if it's not okay with the parents. So
right, so get kids to practice,
get kids
no
to
kidnapping
practice.
And if you're yes. rich, give them money. Those are your
yes, money's always going to not help, not
and
hurt.
With